Audio presents Robert Kirkman's The Walking Dead, Descent, by Jay Bonansinga. Read for you by Fred Berman. Part 1. Lake of Fire. The days of punishment have come. The days of retribution have come. Let Israel know this. The prophet is a fool. The inspired man is demented. And there is only hostility in the house of God. Hosea, chapter 9, verses 7 through 8. Chapter 1. On that quiet morning, two separate and troubling problems lie just beneath the surface of that burned husk of a village, both issues, at least initially, going completely unnoticed by the residents. The drumming of hammers and rasping of saws fill the air. Voices rise on the wind in busy call and response. The congenial odors of wood smoke, tar pitch, and compost infuse the warm breezes. A sense of renewal, maybe even of hope, thrums beneath the surface of all the activity. The oppressive heat of summer, still a good month or two away, has not yet wilted the wild Cherokee roses growing in profusion along the abandoned train tracks, and the sky has that high-def, robin's egg brilliance that skies around these parts get in the fleeting last weeks of spring. Spurred on by their tumultuous regime change, as well as the possibility of a new democratic way of life amid the ruins of the plague, the people of Woodbury, Georgia, a one-time railroad burg 50 miles south of Atlanta, only recently reduced to scorched buildings and battered, scarred, littered roadways, have reconstituted themselves like strands of DNA, forming a sturdier and healthier organism. Lilly Caul is a big reason for this renaissance. The slender, comely, battle-bitter young woman with the dishwater auburn hair and heart-shaped face has become the reluctant leader of the village. At this moment, in fact, her voice can be heard from every quarter, carrying on the wind with authority, drifting over the tops of live oaks and poplars lining the promenade west of the racetrack. From every open window, every alley, every convolution of the arena, she can be heard selling the little settlement with the verve of a Florida real estate agent peddling beachfront property. "Right now, the safe zone is small, I'll grant you that," she is commenting candidly to some unidentified listener. "But we're planning to expand the wall over there another block to the north, and this one over here maybe another two or three blocks to the south. So what we're eventually going to end up with is a town within a town, a safe place for kids, which will one day, if all goes well, be totally self-contained and totally self-sustainable." As the lilting sound of Lily's monologue echoes and penetrates the nooks and crevices of that dirt track stadium, the place where madness once reigned in the form of bloody death matches, the dark figure trapped underneath the drainage grate jerks its charred face toward the sound of the voice with the mechanized abruptness of a satellite dish rotating toward a signal from space. Once a lanky farmhand with ropey muscles and a thick crown of wheat straw hair, this burned, reanimated corpse tumbled through the broken grating during the chaos and fires that engulfed the town not long ago, and now it has gone unnoticed for practically a week, wallowing in the airless, reeking capsule of darkness. Centipedes, beetles, and pill bugs crawl hectically across its pallid, dead face and down its tattered, faded denim, the fabric so old and distressed it can barely be distinguished from the thing's dead flesh. This errant walker, once a captive member of the inhuman gladiators that grace the arena, will prove to be only the first of two very worrisome developments that have gone completely undetected by every resident of the town, including Lily, whose voice now rises with each footstep as she approaches the racetrack, the shuffling of other footsteps audible beneath her own. "Now, you might be asking yourselves, am I seeing things, or did a gigantic flying saucer land in the middle of town when nobody was looking?" What you're staring at is the Woodbury Veterans Speedway. Guess you could Call it a leftover from happier times when people wanted nothing more on a Friday evening than a bucket of fried chicken and a track full of men in stock cars sideswiping each other and polluting the atmosphere. Still trying to figure out what to do with it, but we're thinking it would make a great public garden. Inside the festering enclosure of the sewer culvert, the dead farmhand drools at the prospect of living tissue closing in. Its jaws begin to ratchet and grind, making a papery creaking noise as it scuttles toward the wall, reaching blindly up at the daylight filtering through the grate. Through the narrow iron slats of the overhead grating, the creature can see the shadows of 7 living humans approaching. The thing accidentally wedges its right foot in a divot in the crumbling masonry. Walkers have no climbing skills, no purpose other than to devour, no sentient awareness other than hunger. But right then, the unforeseen foothold is enough for the thing to almost inadvertently lift itself up to the busted grate through which it had previously plummeted. And as its white shoe-button eyes reach the lip of the manhole, the creature locks its feral gaze on the closest figure. A little girl in rags approaching with the group, a child of about 8 or 9 years old, walking alongside Lily with an earnest expression on her grime-smudged face. For a moment, the walker inside the sewer culvert coils itself like a spring, letting out a low growl like an engine idling, its dead muscles twitching from innate signals sent by a reanimated nervous system. Its blackened, lipless mouth peels away from mossy green teeth, its eyes like milky diodes absorbing its prey. "You're gonna hear rumors about this sooner or later," Lily confides to her malnourished clientele as she passes within inches of the sewer grate. Her tour group is made up of a single family, the Duprees, which consists of an emaciated father of about 40 years old who goes by the name of Calvin, his waif-like wife Meredith, and their 3 ragamuffins, Tommy, Bethany, and Lucas, 12, 9, and 5 years old, respectively. The Dupree clan wobbled into the Woodbury town limits the previous night in their beat-up Ford LTD station wagon, near death from starvation, practically psychotic with hunger. Lily took them in. Woodbury needs bodies. New residents, fresh people to help the town reboot itself and do some of the heavy lifting of community building. "You might as well hear it from us," Lily says to them, pausing in her Georgia Tech hoodie and ripped jeans, her hands on her Sam Brown gun belt. Still in her early 30s, but bearing the visage of a much older soul. Lily has her ruddy brown hair pulled back in a tight ponytail, her hazel eyes glittering, the spark down in the core of her pupils partly intelligence and partly the 100-yard stare of a seasoned warrior. She throws a glance over her shoulder at a 7th figure standing behind her. "You want to tell them about the governor, Bob?"
"You go ahead,"
the older man says with a plague-weary smile on his weathered, leathery face. Dark hair pomaded back across a corrugated brow, ammo bandolier canted across his sweat-stained chambray shirt. Bob Stuckey stands over 6 feet in his socks, but he slumps with the perpetual fatigue of a reformed drunk, which is what he is.
"You're on a roll, Lily girl."
"Okay. So, for the better part of a year," Lily begins as she stares at each Dupree one at a time, emphasizing the importance of what she's about to say. "This place, Woodbury, was under the yoke of a very dangerous man named Philip Blake. Went by the name of the Governor." She lets out a flinty little breath, half chuckle, half sigh of disgust. "Oh no, the irony is not lost on us." She takes a breath. "Anyway, he was a pure sociopath, paranoid, delusional, but he got things done. I hate to admit it, but he seemed to most of us, for a while at least, a necessary evil."
"Excuse me, Lily, was it?"
Calvin Dupree has stepped forward, a compact, fair-skinned man with the hard, gristly muscles of a day laborer. He wears a filthy windbreaker that looks as though it is doubled as a butcher's apron. His eyes are clear and warm and open, despite the reticence and the lingering trauma of being out in the wild for God knows how long.
"Ain't sure what this has to do with us."
He glances at his wife.
"I mean, We appreciate the hospitality and such, but where y'all going with this?
The wife, Meredith, stares at the pavement, chewing her lip. A mousy little woman in a ragged sundress. She hasn't said more than three words, other than, or, since the Duprees arrived. The previous night, they were fed, given first aid by Bob, and allowed to rest. Now the wife fidgets as she waits for Calvin to practice his patriarchal duty. Behind her, the children look on expectantly. Each child seems stunned, loopy, gun-shy. The little girl, Bethany, stands only inches away from the broken sewer grate, sucking her thumb with a shop-worn doll in the crook of her tiny arm, completely oblivious of the shadow moving inside the trench. For days, the stench emanating from the sewer, the telltale rancid meat odor of a biter, has been mistaken for the reek of old sewage, the faint growling noise misidentified as the reverberation of a generator. Now, the moving corpse manages to squeeze its claw-like hand through a gap in the broken grate, the moldering fingernails jerking toward the hem of the little girl's dress.
"I understand the confusion," Lily says to Calvin, locking gazes with him. "You don't know us from Adam, but I just thought, you know, full disclosure. The governor used this arena for bad things. Gladiator fights with biters. Ugly stuff in the name of entertainment. Some folks around here are still a little jumpy because of all that. We've taken the place back now, though, and we're offering you a sanctuary. A safe place to live. We'd like to invite you to stay here. Permanently."
Calvin and Meredith Dupree exchange another glance, and Meredith swallows hard, looking at the ground. Calvin has a strange look on his face, almost a longing, and he turns and starts to say,
"It's a generous offer, Lily. But I gotta be honest."
All at once he is interrupted by the rusty shriek of the grate collapsing, and the little girl squealing in terror, and then everybody is jerking toward the child. Bob reaches for his .357 Magnum. Lily has already crossed half the distance of scarred pavement toward the little girl. Time seems to hang suspended in the air. Since the plague broke out nearly 2 years ago, the change in the behavior patterns of survivors has been so gradual, so subtle, so incremental as to be almost invisible. The blood-drenched early days of the turn, which at first seemed so temporary and novel, captured in those yammering headlines, "The Dead Walk," and "No One Is Safe," and "Is This the End?" became routine, and it happened without anybody ever really being aware of it. Survivors got more and more efficient at lancing the proverbial boil, lashing out without forethought or ceremony, destroying the brain of a rampaging cadaver with whatever was handy: the family shotgun, a farm implement, a knitting needle, a broken wine glass, an heirloom from the mantle, until the most ghastly act became commonplace. Trauma loses all meaning. Grief and sorrow and loss are all stuffed down the gorge until a collective numbness sets in. But active duty soldiers know the truth beneath the lie. Homicide detectives know it as well. Emergency room nurses, paramedics, they all know the dirty little secret. It doesn't get any easier. In fact, it lives in you. Every trauma, every horrible sight, every senseless death, every feral, blood-soaked act of violence in the name of self-preservation, they all accumulate like silt at the bottom of a person's heart until the weight is unbearable. Lilly Caul isn't there yet, as she is about to demonstrate over the next few seconds to the Dupree family, but she is well on her way. She is a few bottles of cheap bourbon and a couple of sleepless nights away from total annihilation of spirit. And that's why she needs to replenish Woodbury. She needs human contact. She needs community. She needs warmth and love and hope and grace wherever she can find it. And that's why she pounces on that reeking corpse of a farmhand with extreme prejudice as it bursts from its lair and grabs hold of the little Dupree girl's tattered hemline. Lily crosses the 15-foot gap between her and the girl in just a couple leaping strides, simultaneously yanking the .22-caliber Ruger SR from the mini-holster on the back of her belt. The gun is a double-action rig, and Lily keeps it decocked with the safety off. A single-stack magazine in it with 8 rounds ready to rock, and one always in the chamber.
Not a huge capacity weapon, but big enough to get the job done, which Lily now aims on the fly, her vision coalescing into a tunnel as she charges toward the shrieking little girl. The creature from the drainpipe has one skeletal hand tangled up in the gingham hem of the child's dress, which has thrown the girl off balance and sent her sprawling to the cement. She screams and screams, trying to scuttle away, but the monster has her dress and bites at the air around her sneaker-clad feet, slimy incisors clacking like castanets, moving ever closer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.